Welcome back. We're back here at the Mobile Payments and Identity Influencer Series, sponsored by Jumio. I'm Jonathan Bloom. Thanks again so much for joining us. It's been great doing the series of today. We got a really fascinating interview here. His name is Ralph Danglemyer. He is the CEO of Blue Snap. You may have heard of this company. It was called Plymouth for about 10 years, and they are a custom checkout solution. They sort of operate as a middleware between the vendor and, say, a First Data in the ecosystem. And the man has got a fascinating perspective on global payments, global checkout. And I'm interested, where do you see sort of the big trends now? If I'm really going to be optimizing that checkout experience, what are the real touch points of innovation now?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So there's about three big touch points of integration, because what the merchants are really concerned about is how do they increase conversions? How do they get more shoppers into buyers, right?
Right.
So one of the ways that we help people do that, and we've seen this is coming right out of the merchants, is they want to be able to have people check out anywhere on their site and not be limited to certain spots on their site. We really believe from our conversation with our merchants that people want to buy in local languages and local currencies with local payment types. And as we talked about earlier, there's hundreds of payment types now people can pay with. Otherwise, in the past, there was things like just Visa, MasterCard, American Express. And the other thing that happens is people are now accepting offers at times of checkout, whether it's additional products or warranties or making sure that they've got the full capability of the product being seen before they check out.
Talk about some of those offers that actually drive conversions. What are some of the interesting nuggets or sweet spots that you wouldn't think of that would work in your business?
Yeah.
Educate us on what actually the cutting edge of this is.
Sure. A lot of the consumers are doing free trials, so come in and play the game for a couple hours before you buy. People are offering, if you play a game and you accumulate so many points, you can buy a sword in the middle of a game.
Really?
They let people buy, maybe come in and watch a few TV
virtual
shows.
Virtual goods? Really?
Virtual goods.
Really?
Yeah. Virtual goods with virtual currency.
Really?
A hot topic right now.
Well, if you start dealing with a virtual currency in a global market, have you added a whole other level of fraud risk, right?
You've had a lot of risk in
right,
there, right?
There
right, right. Who's behind the digital currency? Is it a gaming company you've heard of or hasn't heard of it? Is it a corporation?
Bitcoin.
Is it something like Bitcoin where there's really nobody?
Yep.
Right?
Right.
And that's starting up all over the place. And effectively, these rewards that people are handing out in these games is effectively a digital currency. That's what you have. And what's happening now is some companies are actually letting people monetize these at retail stores. You know, very similar to what American Express has done, where you end up with a catalog of things you can buy, golf clubs and airline tickets and jeans.
So it's become a loyalty program. There's a mileage accumulation in the virtual currency, except administered at the point of checkout?
It could be administered at the point of checkout or collected in the game, and it could be cashed in for reward or actually physical goods from someone else's site.
Oh my heavens. I mean, isn't the moving parts, and this is my, I'm not a payments reporter at all, but isn't the loyalty program the great unpaid clog in the wheel, the great, you know, great stone in the mechanism? Because the chargebacks, it's the same cost, but the merchant doesn't want to see a heavily laden, you know, rewards program because it raises the price of the transaction for them. It's a higher chargeback.
Yeah,
right?
it raises the price of the transaction correctly, but if there's a rewards and you're cashing rewards, there is no chargebacks. Because it's like a prepaid card. I mean, there's no chargebacks. So somebody, once they've cashed in the reward, how do you go back and say, I don't want it anymore?
So what are the increased risks there when you do this? Because this is fascinating.
But well,
what starts to go wrong?
Well, there's a lot of things that can go wrong. There's a lot of things that can go right. So let's start with what goes right.
Great.
What goes right is you have more people playing the games, collecting more points. Those things go right. What goes wrong is fraudsters start coming into your game and start pounding on stones and chopping trees down and trying to collect these rewards and points, especially since they know they can cash it in. So you really have to understand the patterns in the games or how people are watching films or movies, because people can just start running through these things to collect points because they know they can cash them in or monetize them somewhere else.
Wow.
So there's lots of fraud starting to be created on that. We just did a session on that here at the show today.
What are some of the things that you do to mitigate that fraud, that risk?
So there's models that merchants build today to really understand their customers. So if someone just signs up for a customer and starts coming in playing lots of games very heavily, or they start cashing in lots of points very quickly, you know, that's stuff to watch. If all of a sudden people start propagating through the game very, very quickly, something's going on, you're really trying to watch unusual patterns. Because a normal person, let's say in a game, is playing a game in a certain pattern. A fraudster is playing in a different pattern. And so what happens is the merchants need to really look at that. And that's true if you're selling anything online.
So right? You're saying it's the basic mix of behavioral targeting, geo-targeting, logical usage of the system. They're just that much more important, that much more critical to the process.
That's right. Knowing your customer, making sure you understand where they're tunneling in from. If someone's playing a game in Texas and all of a sudden they start logging in from the Ukraine, maybe there's a problem there you got to check out.
Interesting. All right, so beyond this kind of innovations and checkouts, what are some of the other trends you're seeing in the show? Talk to us about mobile devices and how that's actually working in the global environment.
Well, what the mobile devices have done is really, it's starting to really spin or increase the buying online. And so I think most of the analysts agree about 6% of all purchases are online, and that's going to 20%. And what the phone's doing is that's pushing that 20% of those sales to be 20% done on the phone, if that makes any sense, which right now is a pretty small percentage. So the phone's just allowing it to be really, really easy to buy online.
Right.
Do you see the risk profile changing there as well? You know, from your perspective as a global checkout solution, talk to me about the risks there, what tools they can use to mitigate that risk, what starts to happen.
Yeah, that's a great point. See, what happens is, what everybody wants to do is when they go online and they go into their account online and they put in their card information, when they go to the phone, they don't want to enter all the card information. They just want to go in and buy now, like you do on iTunes. So if you start doing that amongst many merchants that you have on your phone and someone takes your phone, they can just start buying all over the place and shipping things wherever you want.
Well, in a global market, and there's that lack of transparency,
correct,
because in some local countries, there's just not the commitment to transparency.
Correct.
The data's not there.
Right.
What do you do to kind of manage that risk? Or what have you seen as sort of effective solutions for that?
So a lot of it's up to the consumer, where you can shut your phone down, turn your passwords off. I think a lot of consumers don't change their passwords enough, which they probably should do regularly on those kind of informations. Make sure you're very careful when you give your credit card data. The same thing happens, again, up to the merchant, right? Back to where we were talking about earlier, is you've got to make sure that you're looking for patterns. If all of a sudden someone's buying one thing a week and they start buying 10 things a week or 100 things in a day, that changes patterns. You've got to look for fraud and you've got to notify the consumer.
So you've really got to have sophisticated tools. If you want to step out on the global market, you've got to have an integrated fraud.
You've got to have either good tools or good partners.
Right. One of the problems we're hearing about today is there's almost too many choices now. The space is kind of ripe with innovation. A lot of people are crowding in, offering that full suite of services. Jumio's got one where you can take a picture of your credit card and transact that way. How does a smaller vendor solve that problem? I'm a merchant. Where do I start?
Well, the merchant, I think, he's got to do his research as to what does he want now, what he's going to do earlier. And I think a lot of merchants today need to really follow the traditional path of entering the information online and trying to follow the traditional path following. Taking pictures of cards and lots of ways of swiping, I think, is going to be a lot harder to maintain fraud.
Any particular best practice, lesson you want to get out there, something I didn't think to ask? Because obviously everyone's going global, everyone's going mobile.
Yeah.
What's that big mistake you see being made over and over and over again as a checkout solution?
Yeah, the biggest mistake we see people making is they really don't think enough about how they're going to put their product out globally. They think that I'm going to only start in the United States or I'm only going to do Canada, and then it propagates itself very quickly and they don't have the infrastructure to grow. They don't have the right partner, they don't have the right fraud tools, they don't have the right people, they're not monitoring the right components. So they don't start with a big enough platform in order to help them really grow it.